Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick here in the luxurious state of South Carolina. I hope you guys are doing all right. Praise the living God. You know, I'd made a couple of videos and then they got lost. I'd try to play some music at the same time as the Lord had led me for the theme that the Lord had given me for the coming season of the new year here on the earthly calendar, brothers and sisters, and I lost those videos. Well, praise God, I'll redo them. As the Lord makes a way. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I just wanted to make several videos by God's grace and just say that praise the Lord. Been praying about it, been having it in my heart from the Lord of building another orphanage. So, not 100%, but I ask you to pray about it for God's guidance. As we're looking to go to the Philippines, possibly, say, after another 30 days, so basically the end of January, I'm praying about. If all the, you know, the Lord is the funding, we come together to, we need to buy the land, and I made a video about it, buy the land, and we already have the house, mom and dad. We need the money to, you know, start the construction. But when I would go there now, by the grace of God, I would buy the land, process that paperwork and all this, and then put the, you know, get the new house, mom and dad. I would like to get a few children and put them with them now. See how they do, how they like it, if they really want to, you know, do that, and see how they do and observe them, and, you know, get it rolling like that, and then see to make sure that the house parents are qualified, and then look at, you know, making a plan, starting the construction, and then working on, you know, getting that funded. Also, before I leave, get that all laid out with the builders, the carpenters, and all that stuff. So by the grace of God, that's the plan, brothers and sisters, going to the Philippines. That probably take me about 90 days. You know, to make sure everything's rolling. Of course, it's all up to the Lord. I should pray about that. And the funds are coming in, I guess, for the land and the title and all that and everything. You know, it's $8,000 to $10,000. The land, yeah, it's basically $10,000 plus. You have to do the paperwork, whatever, the, you know, survey and all, you know, all these kind of things that goes along with it. So I guess I really should say $11,000 probably. By the time you do all the fees, it's probably $1,000 through the title of the land and everything. And then also, you know, we would look to start doing construction. But we can always start with a simple facility and then add on to it. That's what we did with the other orphanages. We built some first and we added on to it, so on and so forth. The land we're buying, you know, maybe some of the, it's got some, well, I think most all that's on there is huts. But I need to go there and see. Maybe there is a structure that we can use temporarily, you know, and then move. It's highly possible, you know, and then add on to it. So, you know, I got to get there and check all that out myself firsthand, brothers and sisters, because people always, you know, people don't want to ever give you bad news. They always give you good news, you know, usually when you're dealing with, you know, any people and, you know, they don't want to. Well, that's, I guess I didn't say any people. It's like a Filipino cultural thing. You know, they don't want to say, oh, it's going to be. It's going to cost $10,000. They'll tell you, oh, it's probably, oh, I don't know, maybe $5,000. See when it's really going to be $10,000. So you have to go there, investigate these things, check it out, see what's going on, bring it all together, brothers and sisters. Anyway, praise God, brothers and sisters. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I wanted to make a point on here and do a lot of videos. The Lord just laid it on me. Because I've been asking the Lord about writing, you know, to write another book. I had lots of different topics and lots of different, you know, I guess it ends up there'll be chapters. I've got lots of chapters in my head. Now the Lord has given me the title of the book and what's to be about. So I ask you guys to pray about that for me also. And, you know, I pray that God will provide, you know, people that want to help me edit it, you know, as I do each chapter. I'm looking for brothers and sisters who might volunteer, you know, to look over it. And send it back to me, you know, and edit it, basically. And give me ideas and suggestions of, you know, where it's lacking in understanding. I mean, that's really the thing. I guess that is what you would call part of editing. You know, I don't know the textbook, the dictionary definition of editing. But, you know, it's not just grammar and spelling and things like that. Because this time, I'm going to let them edit it, those things. It's included in the price of what I got when I did my contract for two books. You can either have fast printing or editing. So this time we used the editing, not worry about the fast printing. editing, the main thing that I need help with, brothers and sisters, if you would just read it and say, hey, this doesn't make sense, you know, can you add more details, you know, ask, questions like, well, Brother Patrick, you said blah, 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 what about this, see, so I can go back and, you know, what would the average reader, what would someone be left not knowing from reading the text, you know, what should I add on to it to explain further, you see what I mean? So I ask for you guys' help on that, and then I will appreciate it if you can email me. My email address is below here. It's neartochrist@aol.com. And especially if we already have a relationship, it's not necessary, but I like to work with people who we have some communication with. If you don't, if you've never communicated with me and you want to be involved, just start communicating with me. We'll talk about it, you know, as the Lord leads. Praise God. The Bible says we all look through a glass darkly. None of us know everything. And we're the body. We're a team. And we work together. And there are people with talents. Like, we know when I got to submit this thing, there's people with talents and those kind of things. And there's, you know, and some people do not have talents in those things. You know, like myself. I can do it, but it's just not, you know, it's just like taking medicine to me to work with the administrative stuff. But I can do it, you know. And then some people getting on here making a video would just be like they would have a heart attack. It would kill them, but yet they can sit there and do administrative stuff all day long. So, you know, we all have our different callings and talents, brothers and sisters. So I praise God, you know, that we're the body. We work together, and to get the message out and the word out and the teaching that God wants. You know, there's always people who make the – someone else had written a book. There's a guy who had been a Satanist. And he was a powerful warlock from New York City, from Brooklyn. He's a Hispanic guy. I can't remember his name. His videos are all over the internet. I think it's like Sanchez or something like that. And anyway, he lives in that neighborhood there in Brooklyn of Hispanic people. I think it might be Puerto Rican. His parents or something maybe came from Puerto Rico, whatever. It's that little neighborhood. And so there's Dominion Republican Republic people there too or whatever, and these different islands, and they practice saying Kriya and all this, which is kind of like a voodoo. You've got a Catholicism and idol worship mixed with witchcraft and all this mix of African and Catholicism, like voodoo and all that kind of stuff, like they have in New Orleans. And anyway, he had been a warlock, and this brother, you know, was sovereignly saved by the Lord. Now he's a preacher. And yeah, I like that, sovereignly saved. Hey, that's pretty catchy. Anyway, he was sovereignly saved by God. And became a born-again Christian, and now he's a preacher. He evangelizes. He goes around to churches giving his testimony. He's awesome. And seems like a really good guy. Anyway, so if anyone would know, you know, the way the enemy operates and how Satanists operate and witchcraft and all that, this guy's an expert in, you know, in a lot of those things. So he is someone that can really add to the body of Christ and what he knows. Like someone who's a former alcoholic. Like I talk all the time about Brother Sid, who does the website. He was a former alcoholic for 30 or 40 years. Now he's serving the Lord. And so therefore, if you have someone that's alcoholic trying to get off alcohol, Brother Sid is a guy who can, who knows what he's talking about. You know, so we have that experience, that life experience that God can turn around, something we overcame and help other people. You know, that's how God operates, brothers and sisters. That's why I made a video a long time ago about divorced people. God's not finished with you yet. And of course, there's this... a few people that made videos, they were all upset. A few Pharisees who were throwing stones at me. And basically, they were saying that divorce is the unforgivable sin. But the point is, just like this same topic I'm talking about, if you've been divorced, and you've repented of it, and now you're in a walking relationship with the Lord, God can use you to deal with people who are going through divorce. A, maybe they don't need to, you know, they need to go back to their spouse and reconcile. Because you can tell them, hey, divorce is the last option. You know, it's not something you just hey, I'm going to get divorced, you know. Because the cost, especially if you have kids and things like that, the cost is just so astronomical and so painful in life, you know, and it affects the rest of your life. So if you have kids, 99% of the time they outlive you. So you have to deal with this custody issue. You have to deal with holidays and visitations. And even when they're grown and you got grandkids and then your ex husband or wife wants to see the grandkids at holiday time and you're trying to see them, and it's just like it's just a hassle for a lifetime. That's why divorce is so bad. But brothers and sisters, if we do sin, 1 John 1:9 or 1 John 1:7, and 1 John 1:9. If we do sin, we have an advocate with the Father, our Lord Jesus Christ. And if we confess our sins, he is just and faithful to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us of all unrighteousness. Those two verses are both in 1 John chapter 1. Anyway, brothers and sisters, this guy who was a Satanist and a warlock and all that, he even had people killed by doing curses on them. People would pay him $10,000 to kill their husband or wife or their brother-in-law or sister-in-law, whomever, through all this kind of witchcraft and stuff. And a really powerful warlock. But of course, we know that the Lord is more powerful than Satan, of course, by a zillion times over. And yes, zillion is a real number. And anyway, brothers and sisters, he wrote a book. And as I said, then, I shared the link on Facebook, and then there was someone commenting saying, oh, this guy's supposed to be a servant of God, but then he's trying to sell a book. Brothers and sisters, the Bible is our source. But if the Bible was all we needed, God wouldn't have made preachers. All a book is by this guy is people that can't go see him when he preaches at a church. And then they want to keep rereading the information and digesting it and meditating on it and then go back and take notes out of the book and all that. No, it's not the Bible. Every preacher is just, when someone is preaching and they're a servant of God, like when I make videos, even though it's not written in a book form, it is a commentary on the Word of God. It is, that's how God teaches us through his servants. Now, sometimes it's written down, sometimes it's in a video, and sometimes you go to a church and you hear somebody preach. You say, man, you forget when you go out. Man, I can't remember. What did that guy say who was visiting from New York who used to be a witch doctor? Now, what did he say? Now, you run into somebody that's demon-possessed, and you're like, what did that dude say? What that dude said was exactly what I need to do to deal with this person. Man, I wish I had a copy of his book, and then I could, go back and look it up, and then, go back and deal with this person. Because the Bible doesn't spell out the details of every situation. This book is based on the Bible and rooted and grounded in the Word, and God uses his servants to teach us. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11, he gave some apostles, some pastors, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors, some teachers, for the perfecting of the saints. And so that's how we get raised up in perfection. It's not just sitting there reading your Bible and then just meditating on it. We can do that. But we also need those who are called into different areas, like an evangelist, to help perfect us in those areas, whether it be a pastor, a teacher, an evangelist, a prophet, an apostle. These different areas of the Word of God. Anyway, brothers and sisters, to make that point. And plus, there's just along that same line, there are people who have, for some reason, lots of people are some of the people who would say things like that. Maybe their actual problem is they're rooted and grounded in they're rooted in the love of money. For the Bible says the love of money is the root of all evil. Now, there's prosperity gospel preachers who are telling God wants you to wear a Rolex or you're not blessed and all these kind of things. And then there's people that say you got to eat dirt and worms and live like a dog, and then you're really a servant of God. Now, I dealt with people on both ends of that. As a matter of fact, there's a sister I know from North Carolina, and as we talk, and her idea is that you need to eat gravel and eat sand and dirt, and that means you're being holy. And then, as you watch Turn On Christian Television, and 90% of what they're spouting and purporting and promoting is that, you need to live like a multimillionaire. But the truth is that as God told Abraham, I blessed you to make you a blessing. So the Bible tells us to help widow, perfect religion in James, it says is to, help widows and orphans. And to be without spot from the world, not living in sin, to live in a holiness, a sanctified life, walking with the Lord, to keep yourself spotless from the world and to help widows and orphans. So of course you have to have money to help widows and orphans. It takes money. You can't feed them your arm, even though some people may be cannibals, but you can't, serve them your arm. Now, some people don't have money, so what can they do? They go to a homeless shelter and they serve food, They distribute, somebody that's a rich Christian business person, they go buy, 10,000 pounds of sweet potatoes like that Feed the Children commercial I saw before I went to the Philippines. He says, we got all these millions of pounds of sweet potatoes and we can't distribute them, and a lot of people don't like sweet potatoes, but if you're hungry, you'll eat them, If you're really hungry, you'll eat the sweet potatoes. I like sweet potatoes, but when I was a kid, probably I didn't, But if that's all you had, you'd eat it. So anyway, there's people who can actually go literally distribute those sweet potatoes, even though they don't have any money. They can show up down there and hand them out. So, brothers and sisters, there's a balance in all these things, and it takes funds to get the, you know, in our case, Joshua's ministry, to have orphanages. It takes money to operate them, you know, and God is the one that provides. So people that don't believe, they believe that, you know, money's supposed to fall out of the air, grows on trees, except for their own pocket. They believe it falls out of trees for other people because their true motive is their selfishness and their love of money, and they put money ahead of God. You know, whenever we give to any church or any Christian thing, it's as unto the Lord. If I go down the street on my own, as an example, if you don't want to give to any ministries, let me just say this. I've said this before. If you don't trust the church that you go to, or you know, the ministry that feeds you, then you shouldn't. You know, it's hard to justify. I know that in the twisted mind of people who love money more than anything, they can do it. But it's hard to justify saying that, you know, this ministry's, I think there's something wrong with this ministry and I don't want to support their activities. But yet you go to that ministry and get fed. You know, you receive, you know, a blessing of the Holy Spirit, you might feel, from praise and worship, or from, you know, being prayed for, or, you know, and all these kind of things, or the word that you hear, you're blessed by that. You feed on that. But yet that ministry is that, well, you know, I want to give to God, but not to them. Well, God uses people to minister to us, and God used people to minister to you. And that's what I'm saying. God used people to write a book. God used people to preach. So he also uses people for us to give our funds to. What, you know, what did Jesus say? He said, you know, in Luke, he said, I believe it's Luke chapter 7. He said, give and it'll be given unto you, and good measure pressed down, shaken together and running over shall men give into your bosom. For with the same measure you measure with, it'll be measured back to you. Just like with judging, you know, judge not, lest you be judged. For, you know, the same way you judge, it'll be, you know, that's how you'll be judged. So, you know, we need mercy and grace. We should judge with mercy and grace. You know, we should give out all the grace and mercy to other people because that's what we want from the Lord. And everything God does is based off that. The standard you use, God will use that same standard on you. It's all throughout the Word of God. And as I just mentioned, two references that the Lord talks about that, the Lord Jesus Christ. Anyway, brothers and sisters, so when we give, it is unto the Lord. Now, that's what I tell people, because I have some relatives who are backsliders, and they say, because I've even told them, one time they had a son, two of their sons were on drugs, and they were in big trouble, and they're going to go to jail, and the Lord gave me a word, and the Lord told me to tell them to donate money to a specific ministry. And it's on their own television, but the Lord gave me that word, give $100 to this ministry. It was strange, but that's what the Lord told me. Because the Lord already knew their answer. Just like Jesus told the rich young ruler, sell all your possessions and follow me. He didn't say that to everybody. He said to that dude, because money was his God. He went away sad, that dude. These people, these relatives of mine, I told them that. And they said, oh, we hate that ministry. We hate that ministry. The only ministry that I like that's really, you know, humble guy is Billy Graham. And I said, okay, give that $100 to Billy Graham. Did they do that? No, they didn't. No, they didn't give the $100 to anybody. They put it in their own pocket. They gave it to their drug addict children to enable them to do more demonic stuff. You know, that's how people are. So that's why I will tell people. I'll say, well, I'll tell you what. If you don't believe in giving to any ministries, even though that's what God wants us to do, and, you know, God hasn't called you to the ministry, but I'll tell you what. Go down on the street, just like old Pastor Dave up there in Detroit. People, I see the comments of people attacking him and, you know, because they just don't want to get involved with him because they don't like him personally. They talk about, oh, I want to give to, you know, the Red Cross in Detroit. Well, if you give to a charity like that, for one thing, it's not Christian, even though they call it the Red Cross. They're not telling people about Jesus when they give some food or whatever. And number two, about 90% of what you give goes to the, you know, they got all this administrative stuff. Whereas with an example, Pastor Dave, I'm sure he doesn't have a staff. It's just him. Maybe his family's helping him. I don't know. It's children, his wife, I don't know. And I don't know all the details about, I'm talking about Hung's channel. This is an example. He's going and feeding. So, you know, when he has the food, he's giving it. And not through some, all this administrative stuff. So, as an example. And then he's telling them about Jesus. That's the whole point. You know, you're getting the credit that you gave to God when it's being used in connection with the gospel, is what I'm trying to tell you. If you give to the Red Cross or the Salvation Army, which is supposed to be a Christian organization, and then they have beds for homeless people, but they don't tell them about Jesus. Well, now I'm not 100% sure if the Salvation Army does or not. I don't think they do anymore. But if they did, that's great. Then there you go. You're giving unto the Lord. If they don't, then you're not giving to the Lord. You're giving to, you know, to a worldly charity, but you're not giving to the gospel. You're not giving to the kingdom of the Lord. That's what, you know, when you give, it's to the kingdom of God. You know, so it has to be connected to the gospel. So, as I was saying, if you don't want to do any of those things, you can go yourself, go down on the street, find some poor people, homeless people, or go to a poor family, give them a sack of groceries, knock on the door, and say, here, I want to give you these groceries. You guys look like you could use some groceries, or say it in a way, you know, not to insult them, whatever. If, you know, anyway, and then you start telling them about Jesus. You evangelize them, asking them if you could pray with them, and you give them that groceries. Yeah, you can say, hey, I gave these groceries in the name of the Lord. Even your time, your energy, your gas to go down there. Here, you know, this was $100 of my tithes and offerings, or whatever you want to call it, to the Lord. I gave as unto the Lord. I sowed this seed in the kingdom of God, and I went and did it myself because I don't trust anybody else. That's all, that is also absolutely fine, brothers and sisters. We should, you know, we give to the Lord, to the kingdom of God, whether it be through a church, whether it be through any kind of thing, you know, that's preaching the gospel. We give it as unto the Lord. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I wasn't intending on getting to that topic, but I did. God bless you guys. I love you guys. And I encourage you to give. You cannot give God. Give to any, as the things I just went through. It doesn't matter about, you know, Joshua's ministry, because God is the one. See, that's the thing about it, what people don't understand. If you're walking by faith, you know, trying to walk by faith as best you can, like myself, and I, you know, I can't speak for anybody else, Pastor Dave, as I mentioned him, because I know he feeds homeless people in Detroit. I can't speak for him, and I don't sit around watching all of his videos, so I don't know all the details of what's in, what he says about it, but God is the one that provides for Joshua's ministry, you know, and that's what I say. You can't look to people and say, you know, I looked at, like if you guys have been following me back when I went to Seattle, the guy who was jetting around on a private jet, the guy made zero donation to Joshua's ministry. But there's people that are just middle class or even lower middle class that are sponsoring an orphan. They don't even hardly have enough money of their own. That's up to them. Lord led them to give. They're going to be blessed. You cannot give God. You know, and I, like I said, I guess I should write it in my book, my own personal testimony. You cannot outgive God. All the tithing and sowing and you know, all that, whatever you want to call it, tithes and offerings and alms, as the King James says, alms to the poor and all that stuff. All I've done, the Lord has paid me back a hundredfold. In all things, not just finances, but in blessings, in favor, in the ministry, and all the things God's done. You know, we, as we give, you know, it just comes back. As Jesus said, 36 and 100-fold in all things, brothers and sisters. You know, if you're sick, you have a lot of sickness and disease, go start praying for other people to be healed as an example. You know, it's not always like, you know, you do something and, you know, that's what people love to talk about, you know, on TV. You know, these people are saying, oh, you donate some money and God's going to heal you. So, you know, it's not by works. But I'm telling you that as you sow, you reap what you sow. That is a theme throughout the whole Bible. You reap what you sow. Even in the natural, you sow corn, you get corn. You don't sow corn and get apples. You sow corn and get corn. So it's also true, brothers and sisters, like I said, as Jesus said about judgment. And he also said about finances. You know, you with the same measure you use, it'll be measured back to you. You know, and Jesus said, he who sows sparingly reaps also sparingly. You know, so when you give out love, you receive love. When you give out joy, you receive joy. When you give out peace, you get back peace. You know, all those things. When you evangelize someone else's lost relatives, the Lord will send someone to evangelize your lost relatives. You see what I'm saying? God does that. As we are working and serving him, God is like that. He puts his signature on it. You know, it's not just the fact of reaping and sowing. It's God puts his signature on there. He lets you know that he's pleased with what you're doing. We're not talking about salvation. When I start talking to those old Baptist people and stuff, they're like, oh, you know, I'm the righteousness of Christ. And all that. We're not talking about salvation and all that. We're talking about walking with the Lord in your rewards in heaven and bearing fruit and all that. We're not talking about being in right standing with God by faith. That's where they get confused. It's because they're still day one babes in Christ. They got born again 40 years ago, and they're still wearing diapers and still pooping in their pants and still wah, 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 and whining and babbling and not saying anything. Talk about speaking in tongues. The things they're babbling is incoherent to Christianity. Anyway, I thought that was pretty good too, brothers and sisters. But anyway, I'm just being silly. Brothers and sisters, I don't even know what I was saying now. I already lost it because I was trying to be funny, brothers and sisters. But, you know, when we want to grow in our relationship with the Lord, we increase our faith. You know, and all these things, it's through the experience we have with our walk with the Lord. with our walk with the Lord. That's what I'm talking about. And that's really the theme of the book that the Lord gave me. The Lord gave me the title of the book today. It's really about walking with God, you know, in those things. Walking with God, dealing with all these different things. We're talking about going to denominations. You're talking about giving financially, you know, tithing and tithes and offerings and all those kind of things. And you know, and all of these different areas that we deal with our walk with the Lord. We need to grow in each of these areas, and churches aren't growing people. The church is not growing people, brothers and sisters. And I praise God that the Lord gave me that area to deal with, to disciple people and grow people, to slow down. Not running around, you know, shaking and like a chihuahua and drinking 10 cups of coffee and, oh, there's a river that turned to blood. What? You know, and then just an adrenaline junkie that the rapture's tomorrow, but after like 3 or 4 years, you know, it's like Chicken Little, the sky's falling. You know, it's like the boy who cried wolf. I mean, yeah, the signs are rolling, and they've been rolling, and they keep rolling, and yes, they keep increasing. Hello, that's nothing news about that. People that are just got saved last week are people that's been asleep for the last 40 years, as you know, on a pew. Maybe those people don't know that we're living in the end times. But once you know we're living in the end times, and the rapture could be at any time, but it may not be for 20 more years because no man knows the day or the hour, then it's time to get down to business of being a Christian. It's time to get down to business to being a disciple. It's time to get down to business, brothers and sisters, and that's what it's all about. That's the theme that the Lord gave me, brothers and sisters, for the new year. You know, more love, more power, more of you in my life, like the song. That's what I played in my video that has been lost somewhere on my hard drive. You know, more love, more power, more of the Lord in our life. It's time to get down. And I'm not talking about dancing. I'm talking about getting down into the things of God, getting rooted and grounded down in the Word and in His Spirit and walking with Jesus in the cool of the day. You know, God wants us to walk with Him in the cool of the day, just like Adam did before the fall, brothers and sisters. That's where God wants us. You want to know what the definition of peace, joy, love, health, wealth, and wisdom is? Walking with God in the cool of the day, brothers and sisters. That's what it's all about. That's the message that the Lord gave me for the new year, brothers and sisters. And yes, we plan on fasting. And like I said, you don't have to fast at the exact same time I do because, hey, this is the internet. This is on-demand video. Looking at fasting on New Year's Eve. Either midnight on the 30th to midnight on the 31st, or you can fast all day the 1st, or you can fast all day the 31st. Whatever the Lord leads you to do. A minimum of 24 hours if you can. If you can't fast from food, fast from television. Fast from everything else but reading the Bible and praise and worship and things like that. There's all kinds of fasts you can do. It don't have to be just food. You know, it can be, you know, some people fast from food and they sit around watching TV. What's the point? You know, as a matter of fact, one time when I fasted for 3 days, I invited these pastors over in the Philippines, and then when we fasted, they kept watching Britney Spears videos on YouTube because, you know, I had the Wi-Fi at my house. And then one of the pastors became the head of his denomination on the island where I was, and so they gave him a laptop. This clown is at my house watching these, you know, Britney Spears and all these videos, you know, and it's sexual and everything. And we're fasting and praying for 3 days, and he's watching all these worldly videos. I mean, hey! Come on, dude, what's the point of fasting? I mean, the point of fasting is not, oh, I'm making myself hungry, so I'm holy. It's just like these, you know, the Pope wearing all that big regalia and outfit, looking like a, you know, wearing a big Dagon fish hat, which I'm talking about, not, you know, I've mentioned many times, and all this embroidered, you know, looking like, you know, the king of Babylon, which he is, the king of religious Babylon. That don't make you holy. You know, it's just an outward appearance. So, you know, fasting from food is just, you know, a body cleanse. You know, it's just cleaning your colon. You know, if you're not reading your Bible and praying, that's what it's all about. The fasting is just a way, you know, to weaken the flesh and remind you to lean on Jesus. You know, leaning on the everlasting arms, right? What a fellowship, what a joy divine, leaning on the everlasting arms. I have blessed peace with my Lord so near when I'm fasting. Leaning on the everlasting arms, what have I to fear? What have I to dread? Leaning on the everlasting arms. Right, brothers? You know, safe and secure from all alarms. Leaning, leaning, leaning on the everlasting arms. Right, brothers and sisters? Lean on the everlasting arms. When you fast, it makes you lean on that. You should be leaning on the everlasting arms more. I know I'm always changing topics. I've got lots of more videos to make. I bet the Lord dropped a dozen videos on me today, just today. Praise God! You know, through whom all blessings flow. Praise God, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Praise God, all you creatures here, all you creatures here below. Praise God, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. God bless you guys. Hey, what can I tell you? God bless you guys.